Today's video reminds us that if you're high on meth, it's not wise to mess with a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu black belt. Hi everyone, thanks for joining us on today's active self-protection lesson. I'm your host, John Correa. Today's video comes to us from Tampa, Florida in the United States, was actually sent to me by the good guy in this video. Today's video is brought to you by the generosity of Newbold targets. Newbold targets are self-sealing, reactive polymer targets that act like steel targets for training and practice, but are safer than steel. They allow bullets to pass completely through the target without ricochet or lead splatter. Check out their links in the description and thank them for bringing us today's video. There's all kinds of setup to this one from the video that we have that is important, and you can get it all on the interview that I did with Christopher on Active Self-Protection Extra. There's a link in the description as well as a card up here, and I want you to know that context. So this perp who is on the right has been acting crazy, showing all the signs of a psychotic episode. Christopher says that. He's an ER nurse. He's in a position to know what that looks like. And he has actually dropped his pants a couple times and showed his genitals to Christopher's 19-year-old daughter, and now was threatening the 70-some-odd-year-old across the street neighbor. That made Christopher say, nope, I'm gonna have to step in and put this guy to sleep and get him to not be a threat anymore. That's where this picks up. We do have audio. Let's listen in.
Hi. I'm warning you right now.
Stop. Go home.
Yes, this is my dad. This is my dad. They're fighting right now. My dad just... I'm 19.
Oh, purple. Good, I'm down. I'm down. You're
on camera.
Okay. I'm recording the whole thing.
Are you done? Are you done?
Yeah.
He's done.
Wait for the cop. I don't know what your problem is.
Okay.
What's your problem?
It's fine.
You threatened my daughter again. You're lucky I don't kill you. Do you understand?
Yeah.
You're lucky I don't kill you.
It's my dad.
Listen, you come, you assault me, you bother people, you're lucky I don't kill you. You understand?
He's on the floor, he's fine, he's calm.
We're gonna wait for the police now.
They're fine. My dad's in a...
I told you I don't want to hurt
cops
you.
Get yeah. here, though,
I could hurt you fine. Now, I could kill you. You understand?
It's
you came over, you aggressed
with
my daughter.
And we're outside in the
I could kill you
grass,
for that alone.
So it's not on him at all.
I'm not gonna hurt you, but if you try to get up. Yeah.
Christopher told me in our interview on Active Self-Protection Extra that he sat here with this guy for 20 minutes waiting for police to arrive. And the fact is that they had another priority call in that moment. And then this guy was taken for a 3-day psych hold and then released without charges. No charges ended up being filed in here. That's okay. I think at the end of the day, that's where this one ends. Pretty crazy stuff, all things considered. I'm wondering what your thoughts are. Do you think it was wise of him to wait until the guy punched him in order to get going, or should he have been preemptive? Really be interested in your thoughts there. I think it gave him all of the justification in the world, but I don't know that he absolutely needed to do it, and maybe it was a little dangerous, but he sure was, you know, absolutely confident in his abilities. So let's think about some other lessons out of this one. Really good fundamental self-defense here from somebody who really knows what they're doing. First thing I want to talk about here is the fact that he's got his hands up and an outward posture. Hey man, I don't want any problems with you. The only way he's able to do that safely is you notice he has some distance. He's more than an arm length away from the guy. So if the guy tries to lunge in, he can get that into a defensive fence. But here this is shown very clearly. Hey, I don't want to fight you, man. And that's a real kind of a pro move. It also gives him a little bit more protection if a guy tries to wing a big roundhouse at him or something like that. Not something that I would necessarily recommend for a rookie, but for a guy with a high level of empty-handed skills can work very, very well. So now notice he's trying to get into a place where he can control the guy. So he's moving forward to try to get him to a place, and now our dude reaches out with a little left hand. The reason he reached out with the left hand is Christopher had actually moved to the right a little bit to kind of encourage him to go to that side. And he said in the interview that I did with him that he was waiting for the guy to throw a punch at him just for optics sake, just so that his job, you know, he works in an area where it's a sensitive job and he didn't want to have any problems at all with being an aggressor or anything like that. So as soon as the guy touched him in the face, now that's an assault. Now he can take steps to do that. And notice as well that he's getting a hold of the guy's hands because he knows he doesn't probably have a weapon on him. Now he's going to try to control him. And that's exactly what he does. He closes to a grappling distance because he has a high level of skill there. Standing grappling skills and grounded grappling skills, I think, are an incredibly important part of active self-protection and of being well-rounded as a self-protector. Now, clearly, this guy is a black belt in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. He's been wrestling and boxing since he was young, so he obviously has an incredibly advanced skill set. But even having rudimentary skills, this is important because whether you're the one who chooses, I'm going to wrap this guy up so he can't throw punches at me, or the bad guy chooses to wrap you up, you got to have the ability to stand here. Now, this is what we call like a suicide takedown here, is that he goes to his back. This is not something that I would recommend for a neophyte, not something that I'd really recommend in a street encounter for somebody who doesn't have a high level of skill. Now, he's doing that because he's using that guy's weight and he's going to throw him over the top, and he knows exactly where he's going with him because he has double overhooks and the guy's not going to be able to put any posts down. So he knows he's going to continue to use his momentum to end up in top position here. And that's what you really want on the street. You don't want to end up in bottom position on the street if you can help it. You want to stay in top position as much as you can because that's much easier to control. Now, notice here, he's got a pretty good, you know, choke going on the guy here. But one of the things he notices pretty quick is that he doesn't have a view of the guy's hands and control of the guy's hands. He actually said that in the interview that I did with him. Again, I really want you to watch that on Active Self-Protection Extra. It's really good and informative stuff. And he says right here, he realizes, hey man, I can't see the guy's hands. If he did have something in his pockets, that's his ability to go for it. And so because of that, I'm gonna have to do something else here and move this thing around. He's gonna do that with a good big jerk to get the guy moving in a position where he can and rolls him over again. But watch the hands, guys. The bad things come out of the hands. That's a principle of self-defense. The bad things come out of the hands. See him get over there, and now he is going to really get a choke going in here and get a good solid side control base. And this is a tough spot for an untrained person to be in, and I'm glad that the bad guy is untrained here. As a good guy, what you've got is you have great weight on the guy and a really difficult time for him to buck you off. If you have good top pressure, if you have a good stable base, you can really control somebody from here, especially because of the fact that the guy can't use his hands very effectively when you have minimized space. And if he goes for a tool or something like that, you can see that coming and do stuff to stop that. Really good stuff here. Now he's going to get over into a mount position as well. And the mount position is really good, not just because it's dominant for things like chokes or stuff. I'm not talking about arm bars, or you can start breaking a guy's arms if you really want to. But even more than that is that you're covering his waistband and his pockets with your legs. If you're really low on him here and don't allow him a lot of space, again, with a good base and good pressure, he can't get to whatever's in his waist anymore. Even if they did have something there, incredibly difficult for him to get it. Yes, if he's highly trained, he might be able to, but very few people are. Then finally, I think it's fantastic that Christopher here, the guy said, okay, I'm done, I quit, and Christopher gets off him. He says, okay, man, if you quit, I'm good with it. He fought to stop the threat, not to hurt the guy. Now, I think a lot of people would have wailed a tune on the guy in this point, but instead of that, Christopher is not just an incredible self-defender, but a gentleman, and said, no, okay, my goal was to stop him. Now, the words here, I get it. He's pretty frustrated at the guy, and I totally understand that. However, maybe if we can control that, that would be a better thing, but I think he's taking out some of his frustration verbally rather than physically, and I applaud him for that. And now, last thing here, 20 minutes until the police showed up. Now, I get it, the police were on another call, but it does reinforce, as pro-law enforcement as I am, that you are the primary agent in your own self-defense, and even in a nice neighborhood, it could take you quite a long time for you to have police intervention. So you have to be prepared to deal with the threat yourself, because no one is coming to help you. Thankfully, Christopher had all the attitude, skills, and plan he needed, and this is an excellent example of why I think a highly developed empty-handed skill set is so important to cover your ASP.